Yo, everybody. Welcome to Off Panel, a weekly interview podcast about all things comics brought to you by Sketch.com. I'm your host, David Harper, and this week's podcast is my favorite episode of the year. It's the end of the year spectacular with my pal Brandon Burpee joining me once again to celebrate the year that was in comics. Brandon, are you ready to talk some comics?
Oh, I'm so fucking ready to rock.
Before we get into that, I have to ask you, how happy are you to not be in like a snow fort like I am right now? Because Alaska is getting pummeled. We're in the snowpocalypse. You're in Vegas. How happy to not be in Alaska are you?
I'm so unbelievably happy. I've been hearing stories about how bad it's been with the plows and stuff with the mayor.
Yeah.
And like just how much snow and how they've canceled schools. And I yeah. And on top of that, just I hate snow. Absolutely hate it. So just hearing how much you're getting in such a short time frame and how fucked up it's making everything just makes me sick to my stomach. I'm allergic to snow. I don't like it.
We're supposed to get 7 to 12 more inches tomorrow, and we've already gotten like 3 feet in the last week. And it's
oh my God, why?
We went to the grocery store today and we just like bought up supplies. It's like we're preparing for the apocalypse. Instead, it's just we have snow and no one has snow plows anymore. It's ridiculous. Why did you live in Alaska for so long? It's kind of amazing because I don't know why. I just never realized you hated snow so much.
Oh, I despise it. I absolutely hate it. We moved up there from Arizona when I was a kid and like instantly I hated it. Like, but then I went to college up there, and then after that I got married and then had kids, and it just kind of steamrolled until it got to a point where Laura and I both are at that point. We're like, fuck this place. And then we bailed out to Vegas.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you couldn't ask for a better place than that, because going from Alaska, where 3 feet of snow in like a week period is not typical, but not terribly unusual either, to a desert is about as big of a jump as you can possibly go.
Yeah. I mean, we've been having, let's see, it's 45 right now, so I've been complaining it's cold, but then every once in a while I'll hear a story from Alaska and I'm like, yeah, I'm good with my 45.
No kidding. Anyways, well, we are here to talk about the year in comics. This podcast will all culminate in us doing our typical countdown of our top 20 comics of the year. But before we get into it, Brandon, I just want to ask, how do you feel the year has been in comics? I'm always interested in your perspective because I am so immersed in the world of comics these days. As like somebody who still loves comics but is kind of not as in the weeds as I am, how do you feel the year has been?
I feel it has been pretty good. I enjoyed what I read this year. I'm obviously reading less. I think this year, though, like in previous years, I've said, oh, I'm reading less. And then the next year it was even less. And the next year it was even less. I think I'm reading more than I was last year this year, which is kind of cool. So, but it's interesting in that I'm still not reading a whole lot of news or following what's happening with books. So like, even books I read, it's terrible. Like, you could totally put me in like the TNT, like Charles Barkley, who they play for, but like who writes and draws your comics? Like, I wouldn't know sometimes. Like, it's awful, but just not being in that bubble is kind of nice. But I also wonder sometimes how many books I'm missing out on because I'm not in that bubble. I don't know. Like, I almost feel like I'm in my own little personal bubble this year, but I feel like there's been some good stuff on both sides and of the big two, as well as, you know, from Image and Indies. And I think just overall it's been a pretty good year for me, at least. I mean, I increased my reading for the first time in probably like 4 or 5 years, so that's something.
Yeah, that is something. I do think it's interesting though, because you used to be so immersed in it. Like, I remember you used to read solicits, and I always was like, oh man, why would you read solicits? I still don't read solicits, which is kind of funny. But at the same time, do you feel like in some ways not being so immersed in it and not really, I mean, not necessarily the creators, not knowing the creators part of it, but not knowing kind of what's coming, do you feel like that kind of changes how you engage with the comics? Because I feel like sometimes I know so much that it's almost like everything that's going to happen in it is like kind of predestined. Like, I already kind of feel like I know what's coming. Do you feel like it's more surprising and exciting sometimes?
Yeah, I definitely do. It has a flip side to it too. Sometimes where like when I don't know what's coming, I'll stick with a book longer than I probably would have if I were reading solicitations, you know what I mean? And so then storylines change or writers and artists change, colorists change, stuff like that kind of throw the book off for me and then I want to bail, but I end up bailing later. Mm-hmm. So it's actually kept me on books longer, I think, in some regards, but it definitely helps with the surprise or sometimes lack thereof. Like, I didn't really know what to expect with this whole like Dark Crisis.
Yeah.
So like going into it, I didn't know really what to expect at all. And then as I'm going through it still, I don't know if there's any spoilers like for the ending of it or how it reshapes the universe, which I'm guessing it probably does because they all do.
Yeah.
So to some degree, I'm kind of lost on that. I've been meaning to look that up because I feel like it, by now with solicitations 3 months out, they've got to have whatever the next stage of the DC universe is, if it is in fact a change.
They haven't really said like universal impact. They have announced that there's the dawn of DC, where it's going to be a new wave of books that come out of it and everything like that. But they haven't really said why or how that's going to happen. And as a person who's reading Dark Crisis and there's only one issue left, I can't even speculate as a reader as to like what's going to happen that's going to trigger all that. There are a lot of Earths in play, and I know DC loves playing with its Earths, but I don't know. I do think it's kind of interesting because with comics, I feel like a lot of times our relationships with them, and by our, I mean like the royal we, like the general comic reader, is like kind of impacted a lot by like the constant need to kind of promote the stuff. And it kind of changes our relationship with it to the point where, I don't know, I mean, think about all the times throughout the years where it's like they announce that Batman is getting married to Catwoman or Batman is not going to get married to Catwoman and before it actually happens. They kind of cut their own legs out of it. And I don't know, sometimes I wonder how I would feel, especially about superhero comics, if I didn't have that kind of pervasive sense as to I know what's coming. When we were kids, like I had absolutely no idea what was going to happen next in the X-Men. And I think that was part of the appeal.
Yeah, and that is definitely fun. It brings me back to kind of like a more pure reader of it, you know, like you're talking about when you first started and there was no internet websites.
Just Wizard, just once a month.
Yeah, exactly. God, I miss Wizard.
I have a huge pile right to my left. I actually brought it out from one of my recent podcasts just for like visual stimuli, and I have not put it back since because awesome. I like flipping through it still.
I miss the castings and stuff like that. Those were always so spot on.
Sometimes, you know what's funny? One of the things that I always thought was funny about the casting calls for Wizard was they always cast wrestlers because they are physically matching the characters and everything. Yeah. And I remember always being like, that's dumb. And then they cast Dave Bautista as Drax. And I remember being like, that's dumb. And it was incredible casting.
I thought it was incredibly dumb casting too, because I'm a wrestling fan and he's not a great actor when it comes to in-ring stuff. So I was not sure how I was going to translate. But if you've just got him dropping one-liners, perfect.
Oh my God. I actually, I don't know if you saw the new Knives Out movie, Glass Onion, but he's super good in that movie. And
is he?
I got to say, I don't know if this counts as a hot take. Dave Bautista is a genuinely good actor. That's my spicy take. He's very good at what he does. He's particularly good if he kind of plays meatheads, but he was also in Blade Runner 2049 and he was really good in that too. So who knows? Wrestlers, maybe Wizard knew what they were talking about.
Maybe not. That's why they're gone.
So you mentioned Dark Crisis as being kind of a surprise, and I don't want to kind of cannibalize our lists because like some of the surprises might be good surprises in terms of like something finished high up on your list that you wouldn't have expected. But were there any like surprises from the year in comics, good or bad, that really stood out to you?
Yeah, one that impacted me that I was really stoked about when we're talking about not following the news and not really having the in on things, is for Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles for the Armageddon game. They brought back Tom Waltz.
Mm. Oh, your guy.
Yeah. And so I had no idea that was coming. And then in the back of one of the issues, it had, you know, obviously an ad for it. And I was like, oh, hell yeah. And I don't know if anything else got me more excited this year as far as solicitations, you know, not reading solicitations, but as far as news or discovering something, I was really excited by that.
I love the fact that you don't really pay super close attention to creators anymore. But if you just catch Tom Waltz, you're like, oh, yeah, let's go. My guy.
There's a few out there, don't get me wrong, that I gravitate towards their books in particular because of their style or, you know, what they bring to the table. So there are a few. But in general, there's some, you know, where I just read because of the character. And sometimes, especially with the big two, there's a blending of artists, you know, and stuff like that. So it throws me off.
Have you ever read Radiant Black?
Yep.
Okay. Well, I don't want to spoil anything, but it's funny because I was talking to Kyle Higgins at Emerald City Comic Con, and we were talking about some of the stuff he was doing. I haven't read it. I have the first two volumes. I still haven't read any of it, but I know that he's kind of going for like his own kind of Power Rangers type thing with it. And when he was talking to me about it, I was like, man, this really seems like Brandon's jam.
I can neither confirm nor deny.
All right, we'll get to that later. It is kind of interesting. I often think about, like, when we talk about stuff, talk about comics, I often wonder how, like, that news stuff, not paying attention to news, not being immersed in all that stuff, because, like, I often think that a lot of the stuff that comes from being a comic fan becomes, it almost becomes an identity for people where you have to like kind of be immersed in it. Otherwise you just kind of start losing it. It's actually been kind of nice to see your experience because it kind of shows me that if I ever decided to quit this stuff, I could still love comics and not have to be such like a loon about it all the time. This actually ties into something I wanted to ask though. Like when you're looking at all these books that are coming out and you're not paying like close attention to all of it, like how do you decide what you're going to read now? Is it like instinctive or is it just about continuing with things that you liked before?
Sometimes it's like, you know, obviously if they put out like a new X-Men or Batman book, I'm likely to try it. Mm-hmm. So that kind of stuff is kind of easy.
Do you kind of sample? Like you'll give it one shot. It's like, oh, this is a new X book. I'll give this one a shot. And if it works for you, you'll keep going. Or if it doesn't, you won't.
Yeah, I try to give it like 3 issues.
Okay.
Sometimes more, sometimes less. Sometimes books like Batman or X-Men get a little more leeway. Or if it's a mini, then sometimes I find myself just ending up buying the whole thing if I've already bought 3 issues and it's a 5 or 6 issue series, whether I like it or not, just to have it completed.
Sure.
That's like one part of me that hasn't...
The completionist is hard to kill.
Hasn't gone. Yeah. That never goes away, I don't think. But otherwise, there's a website that I keep track of when books come out each month called League of Comic Geeks.
Yeah,
League of Comic Geeks. And they have like a pull list option, so I can keep track of what comes out each week. And every once in a while I'll look through what's coming out that week that catches my eye, whether it be a cover or a name of a writer or artist I like, something like that. So that's typically how I find stuff now, is from League of Comic Geeks.
Oh my god, that's hilarious. I mostly come across that site when I'm trying to like find images to use on my website, and I'm always like, what is this site? Like, why do I always end up coming across it? I think it's because they're really good at like search engine optimization, so they always finish top of the charts, which is probably how you found it too, but you actually use it for non-stealing images sort of way.
I use it in a complete legit, make sure I keep track of what's coming out, keep track of how much everything's going to cost, because that determines what gets cut or what stays too and things like that. So
you know, like one of the things I think is really interesting about this year is like we're really getting to a point where ongoings are kind of rare. Not rare. They're less than half of what's being produced right now, which is really interesting because like when we were growing up, like everything was ongoing. It's actually not just when we were growing up, which makes it sound like it was a long time ago. I mean, like 10 years ago, almost everything was an ongoing. Does that, like, do you like minis? Does that work for you?
It really depends. Sometimes I like the minis just because then I don't feel like I have to buy a huge string of things as a completist. I don't have to, like, buy 5 and then stick on for the next 95 issues or something.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, so to some degree.
I'm with you on it. I mean, it's kind of interesting because it's like, if there's an idea that seems like it fits like a miniseries idea, like it has a really, like, tight concept, you're like, okay, yeah, I can see that. That makes sense. But sometimes... I don't know. It does feel like when it's so leaned into that direction, sometimes it can be a bit of a bummer because a lot of the books that I like grew, like have ended up becoming my favorites, like I liked at the beginning, but didn't love at the beginning. And then it ended up becoming like a massive, like back when we were doing 4-Color, it's like Scalped. I love Scalped. But at first I didn't like Scalped at all. And it was only because like I kept going with it because I was like, yeah, I could see why this could end up being good. And then I remember around like issue 6, I was like, okay, I really like this. And then around like issue 10 or 12, I was like, oh my god, I love this. And then by 35, it was like one of my favorite books. And it's just kind of funny where I do wonder sometimes whether or not, if it's primary miniseries and stuff like that, if some books will never really have a chance to kind of find their footing that would have found their footing before. I don't know.
It feels like also because is that an actual thing that there's actually almost more minis than ongoings right now?
Oh, yeah. I actually did this article where I went through and surprising you, not at all. I went through a bunch of like solicits and stuff and actually counted out all the ones that are minis and all the ones that are ongoings. And like in a 1 week or actually several weeks that I looked at, over 60% were limited series. So it was like either a one shot or a mini series or like a maxi series. So like 3 out of every 5 releases were like a limited series of some variety.
Wow. And of that 60%, 40% was Batman.
Yeah, exactly. So many Batman books, but
it's crazy. Like I don't keep up on solicitations, but every time I turn around, there's 5 more Batman books.
I do think that that's part of the dawn of the DC thing is that there's not a lot of Batman centric stuff in there. There's like a lot of Superman stuff. There's 2 different Green Lantern books.
Ooh.
There's a Penguin book, which is Batman related, but I was just like Tom King, somebody else doing a Penguin book. And I just remember seeing that. And I was like, Penguin's getting a miniseries or getting his own book. That is fascinating. Maybe it's because they're going to do the Penguin show spinning off the Batman or whatever.
Yeah, you got to have some trade paperbacks ready for when that launches.
Yeah, you do. Yeah, you do. I don't know. I got to say, I'm pretty in support of Colin Farrell's Penguin. He was pretty good as Penguin, even though it was completely unrecognizable as the Penguin.
Yeah, that was wild. That was really good makeup.
I don't even know if he was wearing a fat suit. He was just, he was very penguin-y. So good job by you, Colin Farrell.
Yeah.
Anyways, well, while we read comics outside of Marvel and DC, a lot of our common ground is on like the big two. How are you feeling about like the big two in particular right now? Like, do you feel like it was a good year for superhero comics?
I'm trying to think. You know, overall, I think, because I got to be careful with my answer on this.
You don't want to spoil anything.
Yeah, I don't want to spoil anything. But I think some companies are doing better than other companies at their superheroing, I think, at this moment. And then I think there's other companies outside of the big two who are potentially doing it better, too.
Interesting.
So it's adding a lot of competition.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I think overall it was a decent year. But again, there's not a lot of variety. Like, there is a lot of bad joke, but there's a lot of Batman, which is great because I love Batman. But to a certain point, it's like, all right, how much Batman do I need? Like, could I have like a Guy Gardner book, or could I have a Booster Gold book, or could I have, you know, obviously I can't. Those are not first options when you've got a world of 10 Batman titles.
Guy Gardner was in a book this year. I don't know if he would enjoy the book that he was in, though.
Human Target?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good book.
It's a good book, but he also gets shattered.
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about. I mean, things happened to him that people were not very happy with. I know somebody who found out about that and was very unhappy because they love Guy Gardner as well. And I was just like, he kind of deserved it.
Yeah, he probably did, but he'll be back.
Yeah, exactly. He'll be fine. I'm pretty sure they've already said, basically, that he's fine-ish in a superhero way. We'll find out. Anyways, but yeah, I mean, I know what you're saying. I do think it's interesting, though, because you are... Okay, so let me count this down. So you got a Joker tattoo on your shoulder.
Yep.
Do you have a Batman tattoo?
Nope, just the Joker.
Just the Joker. I mean, you're a Batman fan, and you're just like, a general Gotham fan. And like the fact that the immersion therapy that DC is putting everyone through with Batman is like overwhelming for you, I think it's kind of saying something.
Yeah, because I mean, obviously, if you cut off the market and it's all Batman, then that limits your options to begin with. But on top of that, like, the cost of buying 5 Batman books a week is ridiculous, too.
Right.
Because, you know, you're seeing some of these are like, you know, Black Label or whatever. So they're more costly and things like that. And yeah, Batman and Spawn, I think, is coming out this week. And it's like $7 book.
I am not going to read that. I hate to say it. Sorry, Todd McFarlane. Sorry, Greg Capullo. I don't think you're going to really worry about whether or not I read your comic or not. But it's still, I don't know. It's just...
It's got Greg Capullo. I gotta give it a shot.
Batman, that's true. He is our guy. He is our guy. But the other thing I'm going to say about the big two is I did think, like, I feel like the last, basically since Secret Wars, we've had a lot of events that were like lowercase e events where they were kind of graduated stories. Like Devil's Reign. I like Devil's Reign, but Devil's Reign was a Daredevil story that was put into a larger context because sales. I don't know if War of the Realms would be in the same boat, but, you know, War of the Realms was like a Thor story that happened to be told at a larger scale. This year, I feel like we got two capital E events. We got Judgment Day and Dark Crisis. Did that feel different for you? Like, not even speaking qualitatively, but does it feel like good as a superhero reader to have like big events as opposed to those kind of like shoehorned in events?
Yes and no. So yes, because I love a big event. But no, because my reading style and consumption of the books has changed to the point where, like, I don't really read all the books that Marvel's putting out that tied into
Judgment Day.
To Judgment Day.
Right.
And so for me, it just kind of interrupted a lot of my X-Men books.
Yeah. You're like, what is happening right now on Arako, man?
And then it was like 2 days later, everything's back to normal. And I'm like, what is happening here? I need to go check these books out.
They just had a really stressful 48 hours.
Yeah. So, you know, so it did end up getting me to read the main book, which was pretty good. But at least with Dark Crisis, I'm not really having to read a whole bunch of other stuff. It's just Dark Crisis. And then there are the little spinoffs, but I've pretty much been ignoring them and I seem to be fine. But I do love a big event. I think I was ruined because our events were so good for a while there. They were so good. I think it's just my reading styles have changed.
Well, and also it's like when you're not trying to read everything anymore, events in isolation don't feel that big. It's normally like that area of impact where it's like everything is getting touched. Like the example we always use is Infinite Crisis with the OMAC flying by. Was it Nightwing?
Yeah, it was Nightwing.
Yeah, it was Nightwing, where it's like, oh, he's like on patrol in Bloodhaven or whatever. Well, probably not Bloodhaven because that place was a disaster during Infinite Crisis. But an OMAC just flies over in the background and like that's its tie-in. It's like that was the type of thing where it always kind of had that universal connection, sometimes in really dumb ways, but in ways you still kind of knew what was going on. And now when you're just kind of only reading like the single event and like you're not really kind of reading everything, maybe some of it starts feeling a little like all over the place to some degree.
Yeah, a little bit. But I also try to keep in mind, like, there was a time where I was buying everything that came with any event. And I remember thinking about people complaining about events taking over their titles that they liked and just thinking, well, it's not everybody else's fault. You're not buying all the books. Like, so I have to keep that in mind too, because now I'm that guy, you know what I mean? So yeah. I'm not going to like, it's not going to be like a detractor for a book for me necessarily. It's just, I just have to cope with the fact that when you're reading stuff, especially from the big two, there's going to be tie-ins and they're going to take over your favorite books at some point or another. It's just bound to happen.
This is no slander to my guy, Josh Williamson, but I will say that I feel like Judgment Day kind of played that game a little bit better. Like the kind of making the narrative work without feeling like you had homework to do. Like when I would read, I think it was the most recent issue of Dark Crisis, where I feel like basically something happened off panel and they came up with this big solution. And then all of a sudden it was like, we have the solution. And it's like, read Dark Crisis, the green number one. And I'm like, what?
Yeah.
What just happened? Like sometimes I was like, okay, too much is happening off panel. Too much is happening. But at the same time, I don't know. It works just fine. I would say I really like Judgment Day. Dark Crisis, I think, is fine. But it is kind of interesting because they're both, I think, capital E events. But the scale, at least, it's funny. It's like the scale of Dark Crisis doesn't feel big. And like it starts with the Justice League dying and like having an entire universe being made. And it is big. It just, for some reason, doesn't feel that big, if that makes sense.
No, I agree. And to some extent, going back to what we were discussing earlier, like not knowing that, you know, what huge ramifications are coming already kind of throws that off for me, too. Because with every other crisis, there's like a big reshuffling of the deck, usually. You know what I mean? So.
Oh, yeah. I mean, like Infinite Crisis, like you had such a big shuffling of the deck that they had to come up with a series just to like fill in the gap from the shuffling of the deck.
Oh, that beautiful 52.
Oh, your beloved 52.
My precious.
Before we get into the list, though, how you feel about the X-Men? We're on year four of Krakoa. Are you still feeling Krakoa?
I'll say this. There is...
You don't have to give me a number.
One X-Men book in my top 20.
Whoa, that's low.
Yep.
Interesting.
One book. I just don't... I'm kind of over it. I'm ready for the resurrection stuff to end. Like, there just is no stakes to the game. And then I also feel like they lost the plot line on where they're going with it. Like now it's just like, let's see how long we can milk this.
You mean particularly with like Moira and stuff?
Yeah, like where is Moira even?
Did you read X Deaths and X Lives of Wolverine?
I did.
Yeah, she a robot now, or yeah. Whatever, a cyborg. Yeah, I wasn't really into that. I think it's pretty interesting. I think there are parts that work better for me than other parts, which is unsurprising because that's the way it is for every line. I do think that there are really cool things happening, but at the same time, I am with you to some degree, like post, like in the Dawn of X era where it was kind of coming off of like House and Powers and everything like that. It felt like it was going somewhere specific and like something was coming.
Yeah.
And now I kind of feel like I don't know if it's ever coming. And it's just... It's not bad and it's not wrong, but I do think that to some degree it will always feel slightly unfulfilled to me.
Yeah, I agree. Your architect of the whole thing isn't even involved anymore. Like that makes it a huge problem. Like when you're initially selling everybody on the fact that, hey, he's coming in, he's going to take over the X-Men universe, he's going to run the joint, and then he's not.
You know, to be honest, like that's the funny thing is I'm fine with Hickman being gone. It's just like, I don't know. I don't know if Inferno really paid off that larger story. I thought Inferno was good, but I also don't know if it kind of paid off that larger story. But anyways, I don't know. Well, I still like Krakoa. I think there's some really, really high points in it, as we'll get into when I talk, apparently. But I'm also only reading a few of the books, so it is kind of interesting. It's a fascinating line because I feel like more than ever, you can kind of pick and choose your spots with the X-Men books, and it doesn't really impact you. And I think that there's pluses and minuses to that. And I'm glad I don't have to buy 11 books, but at the same time, I kind of wish I felt like I needed to.
Right. You want to have that urge to.
Isn't that funny? I'm basically saying I wish they were making me spend, like, I don't know, $40 more a month. No, I don't. What am I talking about? I'm insane.
Yeah. Make me want that, though. You know what I mean? I don't want that, but make me want that. Make me come to the shelves looking for it, hungry.
It is interesting. Before we get into our top 20, I wanted to talk about some, like, honorable mentions, like books that almost made the cut but didn't quite make it for you. What were your final cuts?
Ooh, my final cuts this year. I don't even know. I will say Immortal X-Men was close for me. That was a close cut. Ended up getting last second. It didn't make the list due to some other book, but
I know you do a lot of last minute shuffling.
Oh God, sometimes it's terrible. I was up till today still doing shuffling on some of my list.
I made some significant changes, particularly in my latter half, like just a couple hours ago.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know that I have any significant cuts just because I'm not reading too terribly much.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I think there are books that I feel like I wish I was getting involved in, like the JSA books and stuff like that. Those are the books that I was looking forward to, but I need some of these Batman books to die down first.
Sure. My last cuts were, there is a first second release called Shuna's Journey, which is a Hayao Miyazaki graphic novel that was made in 1983 and is finally published in English. Hayao Miyazaki is the guy who did like Spirited Away and like Princess Mononoke and everything. This was like a comic he did like 40 years ago or whatever. And it finally came out in America and it was awesome. It was great. I really enjoyed it. Did not make the cut for me. Freestyle by Gail Galligan, which was a absolute delight. It's a book that is for all ages, but it's super fun. And also it's partially about breakdancing and competitive yo-yo stuff, which is very impressive to me. Fantastic Four Full Circle by Alex Ross, which was awesome. And I thought it was a lock and it just kept falling. It's not because it's bad. It's just like a good year for me. There was another book called Everyday Hero Machine Boy. It is a another all ages graphic novel from Skybound Comet by Tri Vuong and Irma. Oh my God, I forgot the other person's name. I'm so sorry. It's a very good book, very charming. The art by Tri Vuong was unbelievable. Very, very expressive, very fun art. And then lastly, my final cut that I just couldn't include because it only had one issue, but I had to mention it. Kaiju Max does not make the list for the first time ever because it just had one issue. And it's just kind of hard to like put it up there. But I love it. The finale was amazing. It was so good. Those are my honorable mentions. And now, a quick word from one of our sponsors. It's the holidays, and Zoop is wrapping up the year with the completed Saucer Country Omnibus by Paul Cornell and Ryan Kelly, the Whistling Skull Special Edition hardcover by Tony Harris and B. Clay Moore, and several other amazing indie comic campaigns. Your support is greatly appreciated over at Zoop.gg. It takes less than 30 seconds to sign up, and the checkout is easy and intuitive with this new crowdfunding platform. Add multiple rewards and add-ons into your cart, provide some info during checkout, and you're done. No confusing additional steps in finalizing your pledge, and no post-campaign surveys. For creators looking to crowdfund your project, Zoop are the comic book crowdfunding specialists and are currently open for submissions. Simply email them at hello@wearezoop.com to start the process. And now, back to the show. Okay, so it's time for us to dig into the countdown, and as per usual for us, these are all about our 20 favorite comics of the year. And for those who have played fantasy sports before, we're going to do snake draft style. One of us will start, the next person will share two books, then the other will share two, and we'll go back and forth through the remainder of our list. Do you want to go first, or do you want me to go?
Dealer's choice.
I will go, because it's going to talk about something we just talked about. My 20th ranked book, my number 20, is Axe Judgment Day. And assorted minis and tie-ins to it, which was written by Kieran Gillen, drawn by Valerio Schiti, colored by Marte Garcia, and lettered by Clayton Cowles, with a million other people associated. I want to include all the tie-ins because there is a lot of tie-ins in it that worked really well. There was like a Death to the Eternals that I really loved. There was the Omega and Day of Judgment one-shots that led off and finished the book. And then there was also like a Star Fox one, and then like a trio of one-shots that like showed like the inside of the journey into the progenitor, like the celestial that they were trying to assassinate. Anyways, I thought it was the best event Marvel's had since Secret Wars in 2015. I thought it was really fun. It was really entertaining to me. I loved like the detail that they had, like where it would show like kind of the how the people on the street felt about what was going on. That's something I've kind of always wondered about. It's just like when the world is always ending in your like because you live in New York in the Marvel Universe. Like, what is that like? Or if you live in wherever, anywhere around the world, what is the experience of living through an event crossover feel like? And apparently it's pretty sucky and people respond in really weird ways. But I was really impressed by what Valerio Schiti did on the book. Kieran Gillen does amazing stuff. The Death to the Eternals miniseries was really great, too. It was a very fun series. Honestly, like part of the reason why I think I love this one as much as I did is because I'm very in on what Kieran Gillen's been doing lately. In particular, I loved his Eternals run, which does not make my list either, mostly because it finished back in, I think, May. And it only had a few issues this year, so just didn't make the cut. But building off of that Eternals run and his Immortal X-Men run made it feel like something that was really reflecting in a lot of stuff that was going on at Marvel, because it was all coming from the same writer. So it resulted in a book I really loved, which was great. I love events. I want events to be my cup of tea, and this one very much was that. What was your number 20?
My number 20, speaking of things we were just discussing, my one and only X-Men book, X-Men.
Oh, there you go.
By Gary Duggan. I know Joshua Cassara, I think his name, and Pepe Larraz.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the only two I can think of off the top of my head.
Sure.
I love The Vault.
Oh, yeah.
I love Forge. And just recently, the arc that we had was enough to pop it into the 20th position. I thought it was wild and fun. I don't want to give any spoilers away for the... I don't even know if it's the most recent issue.
I think the last two issues were the Vault ones, or maybe like there's been the last three have kind of connected to Vault stuff.
Yeah, there was a big reunion, we'll leave it at that, in one of the most recent ones. And that, to me, that made me pop like a super fan. I was so excited for that, because that's been something kind of in the making and waiting, and you didn't think you were going to get, and then you do, and it worked out perfectly in the shot. Was it Joshua Cassara on that issue?
It was Cassara, yeah.
Yeah, the page of the reunion is perfect. It's absolutely perfect.
I have to say, that book I was kind of mixed on for most of the year, but that Vault arc was so good.
Yeah, it was enough to put it into 20 for me. It just made it. Immortal X-Men got bumped out because of it.
It's funny because I just generally like Vault stuff, but the big ideas, like all the stuff that's like connected to that just is, it's just so interesting. And all the stuff that Forge was doing to kind of deceive them, and like all the stuff he was doing to like get in there oh my God, like that whole thing was, I don't know, it's just really messed up, but also pretty amazing. Like the ideas in it are really, really cool. And I don't know, it worked out really well. I never expected to be all in on like a multi-issue arc where it was very Forge focused in such a way, but it worked out really well. And as you said, that reunion was fantastic.
Yeah, I love Forge though, and we don't get enough of those solo issues of Forge, in my opinion.
You just want a Forge solo book.
Oh, I would love it. You know how good that book would be?
I mean, I guess it depends on who's working on it, but yeah, that's true.
Yeah, that's true.
What's number 19 for you?
Number 19 for me is Robin by Joshua Williamson and...
Gleb Melnikov,
I believe that's right. I trust you over me on that one. But I just really enjoyed the arc they had on Lazarus Island, the fight to the death they had of all the different, you know, characters and things like that. I just thought it was a lot of fun. I thought it was the most I've actually enjoyed Damian in quite a while was during this Robin run. I'm not the biggest Damian fan as far as Robins go. Like, I'm definitely much more of a Tim Drake guy.
Oh yeah.
But I definitely enjoyed the hell of many. Like, it was a fun character, and he got a girlfriend, and like, it just, I felt like they did a lot of developing with the character, which was a lot of fun. And I'm not gonna lie, I love Williamson.
What is your Robin power rankings? I guess it's one through four. Yeah.
Four would probably be
Tim,
Dick, Jason, Damien, and then Stephanie.
Yeah, I guess Stephanie was Robin, wasn't she?
Yep, War Games.
I still think of her as spoiler. I mean, mine, I would definitely put, I mean, Tim's number one for me, for sure. Like, I kind of wonder to some degree whether or not that's just like a generational thing. Like, if we grew up in like, I don't know, the 60s, would we be like ride or die for Dick Grayson?
Probably. We'd be ride or die for Dick.
Yes, we would be. I love Tim Drake. And I actually, not going to make my list, but shouts to the current Batman book from Chip Zdarsky and Jorge Jimenez, where Tim Drake is getting a lot of shine as like the best teamwork Robin. He's very, very well utilized in that book.
Yeah, definitely is.
Okay, number 19 for me is another Kieran Gillen book. So two in a row to kick off my list. It's Once in Future from Kieran Gillen, Dan Mora, Tamara Bonvillain, and Ed Dukeshire. Well, it just finished, and it's basically a story that is like, what if like Arthurian legend and varying fables and stories start effectively influencing the world? And like, what if there is like an old woman who is a total badass, but is very bad at families, that basically has to stop it herself, and like her collaborating with her grandson and his very recent girlfriend to basically stop all this stuff from basically destroying England. It is basically like a blockbuster movie in comic form. It is extremely fun. The stakes to it, you always just feel like something bad is going to happen, but it just plays that card really, really well. It also is completely insane in a very good way. There's like this one point where there's multiple Arthurs who are all trying to stake a claim to being like the person who should be running England. And just all the stuff that they do to like show how this stuff starts influencing the world and all the different... It's kind of a hard book to explain because a lot of it is really about like how you kind of place yourself in a narrative and how that kind of changes your role in it. Like if you have all these similarities to like Lancelot, all of a sudden you can effectively become Lancelot for the story.
Huh.
Anyways, it results in a really fun book. Plus Dan Mora is like an ultra badass and Tamara Bonvillain coloring him is unbelievable. And so it's just one of the best books in comics in terms of visuals. And it's just a lot of fun. I am genuinely going to miss it. Every issue was fun. Every issue was completely unexpected, and that's kind of just what I want from comics. I want fun and unexpected.
All I've got to say is, did you say Dan Mora?
Yeah, Dan Mora, man. Dan Mora is so good.
I did not read that book, but I will have to look that up based on that.
You would enjoy that. I don't understand how he draws so much. He was drawing that at the same time as he was drawing like the Batman Superman World's Finest book.
Wow.
It's ridiculous.
Same quality too?
Oh yeah. I mean, it's so good. It looks incredible.
Oh wow. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's beautiful stuff.
He's a very busy man. Anyways, up next for me is a graphic novel by Jordi Lefaber called Always Never. If I could say there's like one comic that matches my hopeless romantic nature, it's this one. It's the story of a relationship between two people who, in the beginning of the book, it starts with them finally getting together and like finally like embracing their love. And the story is told in reverse and shows like their entire lives and kind of how everything kind of fits together. And it starts when they're old, like just, you know, they're old. They're like retirement age. They're at a point in their life where everything is kind of slowing down for them. And it all starts when they're young people, they're students, and when they first meet. And it is a remarkably charming and lovely book. The art by Jordi Lefaber is incredible. I don't know. I mean, like, there's a joyousness and a heart to this book that is unbelievable. And the cartooning, like I said, by Lefaber is just astonishing. It's one of the best looking comics of the year. Plus, incredible package. Like, the book itself is just, like, really, really well made. Very impressed by that book. I kind of wanted to get it higher, but it's just, like I said, it was a good year. What do you got for number 18?
Number 18 for me is She-Hulk by Rainbow Rowell and
Roger Antonio and Luca Maresca.
Yes.
Yes.
How do you know these things straight off the top of your head?
Oh, man, I've just deleted all of my memories that basically aren't comics or sports. I have to ask my wife what her name is all the time. What's my wife's name again?
I'm telling you, man, you're the Ernie Johnson of comics.
Oh, that is one of the greatest compliments you could ever give me.
I mean it.
Thank you. I appreciate that. But She-Hulk, go.
I just loved everything about this book. I love that it's more law-based, kind of like the TV show was, which I'm sure they kind of lined up. But I really enjoy the love that's been brewing between her and Jack of Hearts. That's what keeps me coming back each month. And then just most recently, the most recent issue was kind of a side off issue, which was wild and weird. And I'm really interested to see where they go with that part of it. But just everything about this book, the art's fantastic. It's lovable. It's fun.
The Jen Bartel covers.
Yeah, the covers are fantastic. The cover with her and Nightwing having tea, or not Nightwing, but Nightcrawler having tea, is phenomenal. That easily would have been a cover of the month for me, was I still doing an article like that.
Yeah. I really like that book too. It's a lot of fun. It's really underrated. I think it's because I call those types of books like hangout books, where it's less about like big action or anything like that. And it's more about just characters hanging out and figuring things out together. Like, I love all the stuff about the fact that like Jack of Hearts was basically perpetually like radiated. He never needed food too. So he has pizza for the first time. All that stuff is super charming. And for the most recent issue, are you talking about the one where it's like the two villains basically, and like their tragic story? That was really good. That was really sad. And like, it was, I don't know, reading that, I was very impressed, because Rainbow Rowell is a really good writer, and she's really good at making you kind of empathize with all kinds of different, every different character. It's not like, those are villains, but they're not, it's like in Wreck-It Ralph, where I think it's like Zangief from Street Fighter. He's like, you are a bad guy, but that does not make you bad guy. You know what I'm saying? I feel like that's those people. They're bad guys. But are they bad guys?
I don't think so. At least not her.
Yeah. They're just misunderstood. Oh, yeah. The other dude's a bit of... he's a little intense. But really good book. I'm glad you had it. It's not on my list, but I really like that book.
Yeah, that was a fun one. That was one that I honestly picked up because of the covers. Mm-hmm. I was like, I really like these. I'm going to go ahead and try these out. And then the inside art was fantastic and the storytelling was fantastic.
It's funny because like... you know, I mean, obviously covers are really important today because there's like a billion variants for like every single comic made.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I also think those like A covers can, like the main covers can be super underrated, because if you have like a Jen Bartel on there, like just crushing it, when you're walking through the stands and you're just like looking at like what's out there, like that cover is going to draw your eye and it's going to make you want to read it. And then once you actually get it, you're going to get hooked. Covers are underrated.
Big time. They are so important. In a visual medium.
What is your number 17?
My number 17 is Hulk Grand Design by Jim Rugg. Fantastic. It was just as good when he did it for the Fantastic Four and the X-Men. It's something I now look forward to. Like, I want to see more of this. Whatever he wants to do, whatever Grand Design he's got next, I'm in for it. Does he have anything planned?
Well, really quick. So X-Men was Ed Piskor. And then Fantastic Four is Tom Scioli. Jim Rugg did the Hulk one. So there, different people did that. However,
oh shit,
I don't think there's a plan for like the for any more. But I'm just curious, like, who would you want to see?
Captain America.
Oh, that'd be good.
I would love to see a Captain America one.
Yeah, that would be a good one.
Oh man, that was totally a I don't know my artists and writers moment for sure.
It's not a big deal. I mean, we got to sort it out. I do think that'd be really good. And also, it would give us an opportunity to see somebody reinterpret Capwolf, which would make me really, really happy.
Yeah. Why wouldn't you want to see more of that?
So is that similar to X-Men Grand? I didn't read it. Is that similar to X-Men Grand Design in the sense that it's like going through the history and kind of retelling it like X-Men Grand Design did?
Yeah, there were two separate issues, Monster and Madness.
Mm-hmm.
And so like they just go through the history. So they pick up, they even touch on stuff like him becoming, I think it was War with Apocalypse.
Oh yeah.
They even touch on great stuff like that. They touch on Heroes Reborn. Like, it's fantastic.
When he was living inside of Franklin Richards' weird blue ball.
Yes. Yeah.
It's really like, looking back on that story, it's just like Onslaught finishes and they're like, oh, where did everybody go? And he's like, I made a galaxy as a child in this blue ball. And you're like, this story's weird.
Yeah, this is weak.
Comics. You're insane. All right. Number 17 for me. And something that I think your kids would really enjoy is Twig. It's from Scotty Young, Kyle Strom, Jean-Francois Beaulieu, and Nate Picos. It is a story. It's one of the best parts of the entire book is the ending and the revelation of exactly what Twig is doing. But it's about this like little furry guy named Twig, little blue guy, whose job is to basically ensure that this stone gets to a certain place at the right time to make it so the world doesn't like fall apart, basically. And he's got this teammate named Splat, who is like amazing. And it's about them like basically crossing this entire world to do this quest. They're always questing, and they go to some crazy places. And like, one of my favorite parts about the book is the fact that Kyle Strom and Jean-Francois Beaulieu always like instead of just like skipping from one place to another, they show us the world by doing these like travel montages where they show like three straight panels where we see how just crazy this world is. And it's just really charming and it's really fun. And it's one of the best looking books in the entire year. And like the finale where like it gets to the point where you realize exactly what Twig is doing is just fantastic. It is a really, really charming book. One of the best looking books of the beer of the year. And like the line art colorist combination is amazing. I think you'd dig it. I think your kids would dig it too. But number 16 for me is one of your dreaded Batman books.
Yes.
It's Batman adjacent. It's a Gotham book. It's Catwoman Lonely City from Cliff Chang. It's honestly like one of my favorite DC stories ever. The only thing holding it back is it was only two issues this year. Two issues last year, two issues this year. Normally, I have a minimum of three issues to like make it on my list because I have to have rules. And this one, I broke my own rules because I love it too much. And also, it's Black Label, so it's like oversized. But it is a definitive Catwoman story. It's super charming. It's very fun. It's also really heartbreaking. It's like all of the emotions. Basically, Cliff Chang takes four issues where he runs you through the emotional gamut and then you end the whole thing in like this amazing place that could go anywhere, but instead it's just a finale where you can imagine what's next. And it's just a phenomenal superhero comic. It's kind of everything I want from that type of thing. And with Cliff Chang drawing it and coloring it and doing all those things, it looks as good as a comic can look. So I loved it. What is your 16?
My number 16 is, and I have to specify on this, it's Detective Comics, but it is in particular the Shadows of the Bat that they did. Do you know what I'm talking about?
No.
So it's basically like the story arc before they stopped and then Rom V took over.
Oh, okay.
I really enjoyed that, using Psycho Pirate in Arkham Tower and controlling the masses of Arkham and stuff like that. I really enjoyed Tomasi on that. I always love Tomasi, so when he jumps on Batman, I'm in.
You are a longtime Tomasi guy.
Oh, yeah. Going back to even beyond Green Lantern.
I'm looking it up.
No, it's not Tomasi. It's Tamaki.
Oh, Mariko Tamaki.
Tamaki, yes. Yeah. Sorry. My apologies.
Is it the right one for your list?
It's the right book for my list. Wrong writer.
Is this the Dan Mora stuff?
No, this isn't Dan Mora.
Okay, it's post-Dan Mora, because Mariko Tamaki did a Dan Mora one, too.
I think Ivan Rice was on it, which was what got me confused.
Oh, okay, so what was it about this one you liked?
So I just enjoyed the idea of moving it out of Arkham Asylum and moving into Arkham Tower. They brought in Dr. Chase Meridian, which was pretty cool, and introduced her to comics, which was amazing to me that she hadn't already been.
Yeah, yeah.
The use of Psycho Pirate as like a way to control the masses of Arkham was awesome, too. I really enjoyed the way they did this arc in particular, because it felt like an event, but it didn't extend outside of that. So you didn't have to read like a million things. It was kind of like what you were saying earlier. What kind of event did you call that?
Capital E event?
Like a...
Or what?
Well, I guess she said lowercase e, the Devil's Reign event.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it was a lowercase e event, and I really actually enjoyed the way they played it out. And I like that they brought back Shadows of the Bat as a title for it, too.
Yeah. It's fun when they kind of do throwbacks like that, where they kind of give you a hint as to kind of what the tone and everything is going to be like. And like, sounds like it really worked for this one.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun.
What was your number 15?
Okay, and this is why I had to specify, because next is Rom V and
Raphael Albuquerque.
Raphael Albuquerque's Detective Comics.
Oh my God, the double detective.
Yeah, double detective. I had because it's a clear break between the two. You know what I mean? So like, couldn't really lump them in as one.
I just want to say I love that we have three straight Batman related books.
No, that's hilarious. What years has that ever happened? I don't think ever.
Ever? No, probably not.
No. Oh, that's fantastic. You got another Batman coming, don't you?
I don't know.
So the art for this, Raphael Albuquerque on Batman is just a no-brainer.
Yeah.
It's just beautiful stuff. And they've done a great job of playing around with like the darkness of everything and bringing in Nightwing for a little bit. Just overall, if you wanted a Batman book like to feel like a dark detective Batman book, this is it. I mean, and Rom V had a great run on Catwoman I really enjoyed, and that's one of the big things that brought me onto it. This run was just trying to fall off of that, because after he left Catwoman, it also went downhill.
I know you previously liked the Swamp Thing stuff he was doing too, so it seems like he's speaking your language.
And it's funny, because I don't really love horror comics, but I feel like he does a good job with a, not necessarily to pigeonhole like a horror vibe, but like a dark brooding overtone, like just that feel of impending doom. He does such a great job. So yeah, and He does it here with Batman.
Yeah. I like the operatic tone to it, where it's like always like themed to music and everything like that. He does a really good job with that. It's like in the wrong person's hands. I don't know if that idea would work, but it does work.
Yeah.
Speaking of ideas that wouldn't work in other people's hands, there's a book from Image that's my 15th book. It's called Ghost Cage. It's from Nick Dragotta, Caleb Gellner, Russ Wooten, Frank Martin Jr., and David Brothers. This book is insane. It is like completely insane. It's kind of like, do you ever watch The Raid or Dread? Like the most recent Dread with Carl Urban in it.
Yeah, yeah.
So like basically it's like one of those stories where you're going up levels to try to like, it's kind of like a video game where you're like going up the levels and there's always like kind of like these boss fights and stuff like that. This basically has that whole idea, but it's like, I don't even know how to compare it. It's just like, it's got a little bit of that mixed with just like a lot of like manga and anime influence. I mean, I'm going to read you the solicit. I actually brought it up just so I could read it because it's like hard to explain. When his megacorp power plant falls under attack by terrorists, the super scientist who revolutionizes and controls all energy on Earth sends his ultimate creation and an adequate employee in to destroy his most monstrous secrets. It's really funny and it's really weird and it's completely insane. And the action is amazing. Like, I love Nick Dragotta's art. He is one of my favorite artists. And his stuff in this is just pure him to the absolute max. And it's like just three issues and all of them are oversized and it's just bonkers. I just really love it. I mean, it's kind of funny. It was one that I considered moving a lot of my books up or off or down or whatever. It just kind of was always here. And it's just because it just always stood out to me. Like when I look back on all the books, I'm always just like, yeah, Ghost Cage was great. I didn't read anything else like that. And it's not very often you can say things like that. And That one was just one that really worked. I think you'd really dig it. It's very much a Brandon book.
I'll have to check that one out.
Number 14 for me is a graphic novel from Archaea Boom called I'm Still Alive. It's written by Roberto Saviano, and the art is by Asaf Hanuka. Now, the thing I got to say about this, though, is I don't actually know if Hanuka only did the art for it. I'm pretty sure he basically wrote the graphic novel itself, and he was adapting Saviano's words, because basically it's the story of the life of this guy named, well, Roberto Saviano, who has been in effectively witness protection, but he's been under police protection since, God, I don't even remember, like a long time, like decades, because he did reporting and wrote books about the Italian mafia to the point where his life has been under threat ever since then. And it's about what life would be like if you lived his life. And I'm not gonna lie, I am not envious of his life, but I'm very glad that he did those things, because it's like saying truth to power is always really impressive. But the thing that really works about it, beyond the fact that Saviano is really interesting, this book is just like incredible, because getting inside the brain and the life of like somebody who basically cannot leave a room for extended periods of time because he's being protected by the police should not be that exciting. But the way he does, like Hanuka tells this story, is just so impressive that you're like really, really invested in it. And you just can't help but imagine what it would be like to live this sort of life. You can't help but, you know, think about all the challenges this dude has faced. And it's just so impressive. It's really, really well done. I cannot say that I would ever speak truth to power when it involves the Italian mafia, because I don't think I want that life. But I mean, anyone who's read Saviano's stuff, you should definitely read this too, because you get a tour of what his life is really like. And it's just a remarkable work. What do you got for 14?
Number 14 for me takes me outside of the big two for the first time on my list and brings me to Image, where I find What's the Furthest Place from Here?
Ooh, good book.
Very big fan of this book. I don't know what it is about this book, but it's one of those books that immediately I clung to it. It was fantastic. From the cover,
it feels like a Brandon book.
Yeah, the covers, the art, the post-apocalyptic Peter Pan style world of Neverland is something crazy. And just seeing how that mystery is playing out, and just kind of getting to see different facets of the community, I guess it would be. That you continuously see issue by issue. I think they've done a great job of world building. Sorry, I should say Tyler Boss and Matthew Rosenberg. have done a great job of building a whole world that I want to see more of. I don't know if this is a mini series, a maxi series, an ongoing. I have no idea, but I know that I'm in it for the long haul, no matter how long it goes.
I love how all these different groups of young people are defined by basically where they're being raised at, where it's like the academy is all like raised in a record store. And so they're all like their entire life existence, their society is based off of finding the record that defines you basically as a person. What would your record be?
Oh man, my record that defines me, just because I don't go fuck, is All Eyes on Me by Tupac.
I knew it would be.
I would have to take it.
Yeah, mine would be Jens Lechman's Night Falls over Cortadala, because unlike you, I'm a very soft boy.
Yeah.
But I'm sensitive, Brandon.
I'm a sensitive boy.
It's a really fun book, and they have some really cool ideas to it. Did you know that there's a version that comes out that has a record that Matthew Rosenberg has had produced with like different artists doing, where it's just like a 7-inch single song record that ties into the book basically? He's had some pretty amazing artists who've done it. It's like the production, all the stuff that goes into it is kind of insane.
Oh my God, I did not know that. And as somebody who is
You're a big
huge
vinyl guy.
Collector, yeah, like I did not know that, but that gave me a huge chub.
Man, you honestly, like you would definitely be in the academy. I kind of feel like you're in the academy anyways. I mean, your Instagram is Vinyl Burpee.
Yep, all vinyl all the time.
All right, what's your number 13?
Number 13 for me takes me back to DC, but into Black Label with Rogues.
Ooh, fun book.
By Joshua Williamson and Leo Max.
Leo Max, yep.
Yeah, so overall, just a great book about a heist in Gorilla City, like, but done so fun and so well. Leonard Snart is just a giant bastard, and
the perfect description.
He's the absolute worst.
Yeah,
but you also can't get enough of him.
Yeah,
it's just so well done, and the art by Leo Max is just fantastic. There is not another artist that could have done this book, in my opinion. It's just perfectly matched with the style here, as far as I can tell. I've never seen any of his other stuff or her other stuff or their other stuff, but I am just it's a name now that will stick with me, and if I see it on something, I'm more than likely to try it out now.
I highly recommend the Hill House Comics / Black Label release Basket Full of Heads, which was drawn by Leo Max and it was written by Joe Hill. It is awesome. I think you'd really dig that, and you would dig Refrigerator Full of Heads, which is the sequel that is not drawn by him, but is also really fun and completely insane. Speaking of, that book did not make my list, but I love it. Also, Rogues was really good. It didn't make my list. It is really fun. I love how it get like what it does with the Rogues is really smart, and it really does underline the relationships, and as you said, how big of a bastard Snart really is. He's a terrible person. I mean, like,
horrible.
Well, I mean, there's scales to like being a bad guy, and he's like, he is a bad guy. He's very bad. He's a bad man. And but at the same time, like, it speaks to how well that Josh Williamson writes him, that he's a terrible person, but you're so invested in reading about what he's going through.
Yep. That Joshua guy, he might have a career.
He's pretty good. He's pretty good. 13 for me is The Night Eaters. She Eats the Night. It's a first book of a 3-part graphic novel series from Marjorie Liu and Sana Takeda. I love the fact that they're doing Monstrous and they're like, you know, let's just take a quick break and make an entire graphic novel series. I'm like, that's not a break. When I have a break, I just like watch a movie and eat Reese's peanut butter cups. I mean, like, they make an entire other graphic novel series. But the good news is it's incredible. It's fantastic. It's a horror book, but it's also it's funny. It's like, it is a horror book, but it's really about family, and it's really about like our relationships. And it's funny because as I told Marjorie came on the podcast, and I told Marjorie about how it really reminded me of Amber's family and like Amber's family history in a lot of ways. Minus some significant details. There's no like horrible dolls that are like horrific and vaguely related to demons in it.
What?
In Amber's family. Yeah, there's a lot of freaky stuff in this book. Amber's family, thankfully, is doll-free. And Sana Takeda's art is incredible. The main character in the book is this mother figure. Her commitment to smoking is so impressive in this book. It's weird that is like a very small thing that I really loved about it. But it's just, there's one scene where she flicks a cigarette at a rabbit, And the next time, like the very next panel, she's already got a cigarette again in her mouth smoking. And it isn't like a weird no prize situation. It's just she really, really loves smoking. And there's going to be more to come with that, apparently. I love the fact that that is apparently a plot point. It's a really great book. I really liked it. I actually really expected it to finish higher. It just didn't. Competitive year. Number 12 for me is Clementine Book 1 by Tilly Walden and Cliff Rathburn. Did you ever, you probably didn't, but there's like a video game series for The Walking Dead, Telltale The Walking Dead. And I loved that series. I was like ride or die with that. The main character in it ultimately is this young girl named Clementine who's like growing up in the, you know, zombie apocalypse. And apparently it's not a great time to grow up if you want to be, have like a fairly normal life. So that whole thing is about her going through that experience. And Clementine continues that after the book or after the video game series finished. Basically, if you had asked me before they announced the book, if you could have one creator who could possibly continue Clementine's story, I would have said Tilly Walden, who has done a bunch of graphic novels and she fits this type of story and this type of character perfectly. And they did it. They managed to actually cast her as like the person to actually make the story. And it resulted in a really great book that continued her storyline perfectly. And I love it. I just absolutely loved it. It's such a good book and it's a perfect continuation of that story. Yeah, I don't know. It's funny. It's like I feel like it's a Walking Dead book that people have slept on. But at the same time, I don't even know what that means. It probably sold a ton and I don't even know it. What is your number 12?
All right. My number 12 is a book that we touched on earlier, and that would be A Swamp Thing.
Ooh.
Rom V making a double A on my list this year.
Yeah, we're in like the Rom V section of your list.
Yeah, it's perfect. And Mike Perkins?
Mike Perkins, that's correct.
This is a book that shouldn't be, as far as I'm concerned, because I don't read solicitations, and I didn't realize until way late in the game, and I think you might have even told me on one of these podcasts that they were continuing the story past what it was supposed to be originally.
Because it was originally going to be 10 out of 10, and then they were like, second season, 10 out of 16.
Yeah, so this is a book that shouldn't even exist, as far as I knew, up until I think you told me. And so this, for me, was just a cherry on top of the previous 10. This was just beautiful stuff. The art on this is so haunting and so badass. The green never looks so good. And Rom V, just again with that dark, overbearing feel of their writing, is just so fucking good. And I'm not a huge Swamp Thing fan, but this is definitely the best it's been. And this is going to sound crazy, but since New 52.
I mean, I don't really know how much Swamp Thing there's been since the New 52.
I mean, more crazy, because I'm actually going to say something that was pretty decent from the New 52.
Oh, okay. There's
a
few
things. Yeah, but that was one of them.
That was Snyder, right?
Yeah, Snyder.
And Yannick Paquette. Yeah, that was good. Yeah, I mean, it's funny, too, because it's like Swamp Thing is like one of those characters that has like a legacy to him that a lot of top creators have worked on it. And like following in those footsteps must be a lot. But Rom does a really good job on that. I got to say, I'm with you, though. Mike Perkins, I never expected him to do a like Swamp Thing type book, but he totally helps. Like you're talking about Rom and how he's got like that sense of foreboding and the idea. Mike Perkins does a remarkable job of giving that whole book this like crazy intense atmosphere throughout, especially with the colors. I actually don't remember who the colorist of it is, but that book just, it feels intense throughout. And like it needs to, and it does it really, really well.
Yeah. There's not more issues coming, is there?
I don't believe so, but who knows? We'll wait until the next.
I was hoping you'd give me some great news for next year.
Oh, they're just going to keep throwing out new seasons every once in a while just to keep you on your toes. Who knows? We'll see. Maybe there's going to be another Dawn of the DC and it'll be Rom back on Swamp Thing.
That would be amazing.
What is your number 11?
Number 11 for me is a perennial favorite, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
Yeah.
Kevin Eastman, Sophie Campbell, and Pablo Tanica on art.
All right.
I have really enjoyed Sophie Campbell's run with the whole mutant town perspective of the Ninja Turtles instead of focusing so much on them going out and like kicking foot ass.
I don't know why that phrase is hilarious. Kicking foot ass.
Yeah, that sounded weird when you say it. Yeah, it makes sense in context.
It does.
But the foot ass kicking takes a seat for a little while, and you get more of like a community feel of Mutant Town and like them trying to set up a paper and a constable and Jenica and things like that, and seeing how Mutant Town evolves and has grown. But it's getting to a point where it feels like Mutant Town has reached its peak. And just about that time, they start doing Armageddon Game, which starts bringing back that action. So one of my huge compliments to this book is it's continuously in its run very well. It's done a great job of riding the ebbs and flows of everything and getting to a point where it knows it's time to move on and pivot. It does a phenomenal job, and it's doing that here without sacrificing anything that's already been built up on. They're not destroying everything and starting from scratch. It's just a pivot in the action. Just fantastic stuff. And this is separate from what's going on with the Armageddon Game miniseries, which is Tom Waltz. This is all Sophie Campbell. I think Tom Waltz may have some kind of say in something just because it ties in with Armageddon Game, but fantastic stuff. Yeah, and the art, Pablo Tunica is the only one I can think of off the top of my head, but continuously top-notch art.
I gotta say, Armageddon Game, A-plus name.
Yeah.
I can't believe I've never heard that in comics before. It feels like it should have been an event like 15 years ago.
All led by the Rat King.
The Rat King. Ooh, I like it. I gotta say, I gotta get your take on this. How do you feel about Dark Crisis as a event name?
I felt like it was too close. Like, I felt like, what was the last Dark whatever DC did? Dark Met? No. They did something just recently that was Dark, and it confused me.
Yeah, the thing about Dark Crisis, that it made me laugh when I first heard it, and I remember telling Josh that, and he was just like, why is it so funny? I'm like, I can't explain it. It just feels funny to me, and it is. And then they made a Dark Crisis on Infinite Earths, and I don't know if it made that more funny or less funny, but it might just be equally funny. It's just all funny to me.
Yeah.
All right, 11 for me is Reckless, the Reckless series by Ed Brubaker, Sean Phillips, and Jacob Phillips. Specifically, there was two graphic novels that came out in this series this year called Follow Me Down and The Ghost in You. I would say that those are probably the two best from the five that they've come out with so far. I mean, it's Ed Brubaker and Sean Phillips. They're always good. This is one of the funny things. We've talked about this a lot in the past. It's really difficult placing some books. It's like probably Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles is like this for you, where it's been good for so long that it's not that it's not good. It's just like sometimes it can make it difficult to stand out relative to like how good it normally is, if that makes sense.
Yeah, that makes total sense.
Yeah, it's like I used to call it the metronome books. And like this is like Reckless is so good and it always is so good. But at the same time, it's like, maybe it's a little bit less spicy than some of its peers. And so I might place it a little bit lower than it maybe deserves relative to how much I like it. I will say it was 16 earlier. I moved it all the way up to 11 because that felt more right. And I did a bunch of shifting. I wanted to get it in my top 10. I got a strong top 10, Brandon. It's just the way it is. And now a quick word from one of our sponsors. It's Bad Idea. And the Renegade comic book publisher is back doing their crazy antics. The latest includes putting a comic from Mark Waid and David Lapham, The First Supper, into a recent edition of Previews for Order completely randomly. Or it was the latest, until Bad Idea also snuck a new comic from Joshua Dysart and Kano, The First 7 Days, into the same edition of Previews. Don't worry if you missed it, because you probably should have, as it was hidden under the publisher name B-Side Press with fake creator names. That's how Bad Idea rolls, though, making notable comics with great creators in extraordinarily unusual ways. Keep your eye out for whatever is next with Bad Idea, if you can. And now, back to the show. Number 10 for me, and something that I hope shows up on your list later, because I feel like this book is extremely Brandon, is 8 Billion Genies from Charles Soule, Ryan Brown, and Chris Crank. It is one of the best concepts ever, and it's so smart in the way that they're doing it. The concept, in case you're not reading it, is basically, well, the title says it. It's about like what happens if every person in the world gets a genie, where you get one wish. And the very short answer is things go poorly because people are stupid and they make very irrational decisions involving what they want to do. Like, I want to become a dragon, or I want to... like, have dragons. Just anything involving dragons just seems like a bad idea. There's a lot of bad decisions made, and it basically follows along a very extended time frame to show what happens to the world as the impact of these wishes keep being felt. And the thing that's really impressive about it is it's like such a tonal melting pot. It's funny because it's Charles Soule and Ryan Brown, and they always have fun together. It's genuinely hilarious. It's really inventive, and it's also like surprisingly moving. I mean, Curse Words was too, but this one it really, like the relationships in it are just really fantastic. It's such a good idea. Even if it was just the idea, I think I would have liked it, but the execution is even better than the idea, and it results in a really great book. Also, bonus points because it's a great idea, but it's also one that they were smart enough to realize should be finite. So it's an 8-issue series where each issue kind of tackles a certain time period, and it works really well because of it. I'm glad it's not an ongoing. If it stretched out for too long, it just wouldn't have worked. This works perfectly because of it. So that's my number 10. What do you got?
I'll have to check that out. I'm not reading that. I've heard of it, but I'm not reading it. And knowing that it's 8 issues, I'll probably buy a trade of that.
Oh my God. You'd love it. It's really fun and it's insane. And yeah, I don't even know what I would do with my wish. It would be terrible. I would definitely do something stupid with it. Probably.
I'd be rich, bitch.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, of course, money is not very useful when everyone else has got dragons, unfortunately.
But I'll be rich.
Yeah, you'll be rich. That's true. What's number 10?
Number 10 for me brings back the lowercase e events with Devil's Reign.
There you go.
Chip Zdarsky and Marco Cicchetto. How do you say it?
Cicchetto. I think. I don't know. I apologize in advance. I guess I apologize in retrospect. I already said it. If I'm wrong, I'm sorry. I actually did very much look up how to pronounce his name once, and I may just be really confident about my mispronunciation. So anyways, Devil's Reign, go.
Yeah, so I enjoyed, I guess, the small E events this year. I like that they were a little more contained. I felt like Devil's Reign did have tangent issues, obviously, that tied in. Mm-hmm. But it was another one of those ones I felt like I didn't really need to read them necessarily to understand what was going on. And so I felt like it was a little more insular in that way. And the art on this is phenomenal. Chip Zdarsky's Daredevil is just fantastic. And so to get this little event wrapped around that was fantastic as well. You get Thunderbolts in a new iteration, which I love me some Thunderbolts.
They're kind of like fascist police Thunderbolts, though.
Yeah, this time they weren't as cool. But they were still fun.
I like all the Purple Man stuff, like Purple Man and the Purple Kids. There's a lot of purples going on.
Yeah, there's a lot of purple love.
And also Luke Cage becoming the mayor. Good job, yeah. Mayor-elect Luke Cage.
Luke Cage mayor is fantastic, and that's got ongoing repercussions on a great level.
Yeah, I really like the fact that there was a lot of like repercussions from that. I also am glad that everyone agreed that Tony Stark should not become the mayor because he would be a horrible mayor.
Terrible.
He might be one of the worst options you could get from the entire Marvel Universe.
Yeah, I would not vote for him.
Can I ask you a quick question that has nothing to do with this besides like Tony Stark being bad at stuff?
Yep.
Who do you think would be a worse NBA owner, Lex Luthor or Tony Stark?
Tony Stark.
Absolutely. 100% agreement.
Without a doubt. He'd play too loosey-goosey with it and shit. I don't think he'd put as much attention into it. He wouldn't be like a Mark Cuban type of Tony Stark.
I feel like Lex Luthor would be like Steve Ballmer from the Clippers, where he would spend all of his money like making sure that team is good, and they would be like billions into the luxury tax. And he would sit courtside and just scream constantly about like going on the fast break.
Demand wins.
Exactly. He would be demanding wins. It'd be ridiculous. He would also probably have his fellow owners killed, which would not be good, but... Anyways, I like Devil's Reign.
We'll deal with that when we get there.
I like Devil's Reign. That was a good one. What's your number 9?
Number 9 for me takes me back over to Image with Radiant Black.
There we go.
There it is. This is a great superhero book, building a great superhero universe on top of it. It is very much so, like you described, almost like a Power Rangers, because you got a pink, yellow, blue, black, white, green, purple, turquoise. Yeah, you got them all now. And then they've done a great job of spinning off little miniseries to focus on them without shifting the focus off of the actual Radiant Black book. And it's great because they do like short minis, you know, like, so it's not you needing to buy a whole nother ongoing, but it also ties into other books like Rogue Sun and things like that. They've built almost like what Invincible did for a little while there with their universe. Not to the same degree, obviously, because Invincible is just Invincible, but Radiant Black does a great job of building out a superhero universe outside of the big two. And I think to some degree has done a better job of building that superhero universe without cramming it down your throat like some of the other ones do.
So that's what you were referring to earlier.
Yeah, a little bit. I think they've done a great job. I don't think it's the best superhero comic book on the market, because obviously it's number nine. But it does a great job, and it really sets the tone of how you can do this outside of being underneath the umbrella of the big two, I think.
Yeah. My next two, I'm going to do together because they're back-to-back making a lot of sense, or more specifically, they're X-to-X. We got number nine, Immortal X-Men by Kieran Gillen, Lucas Wernick, Michelle Bendini, David Curiel, and Clayton Cowles. And then number eight, X-Men Red by Al Ewing, Stefano Caselli, Federico Blee, and Ariana Maher. I had, like, trying to split these two, like, even in order was really difficult to do. And then trying to decide which one was better in my mind, especially because they both have nine issues. They both hit a lot of the same territory because they have overlap with Judgment Day. They both have a lot of these different things. Was kind of difficult because I love them both for, like, I look at them as like twin books. Like, I just talked to Kieran Gillen for the podcast and I asked him if he kind of views these as twin books to some degree. And I will let him answer it when I, you know, that podcast comes out after this one. But the ultimate point, though, is like, I like that Immortal is kind of the look at the way that Krakoa works through the Quiet Council. And then X-Men Red is a look at this, like, the mirror image on Arako and about how all that stuff works. And it does, like, the latest issue has this moment with Roberto da Costa that is so badass that I'm trying to remember how I wrote about it already. And I think I described it as like a moment that, like, as soon as you see it, is like tattooed on your soul. And it's so awesome. It's just so awesome. I'm really into these superhero books that kind of are less about like violence and more about like political machinations and kind of how they're all trying to like get power in these like new context, and they work really, really well for me. Eternals was similar. Like, I think it's a kind of the same kind of species of superhero comic in that regard. But Immortal X-Men and X-Men Red are by far my favorite X-Men books. They are the flagships, and they are my everything when it comes to X-Men right now. I love them. They're amazing. What is your number eight?
Number eight for me is Darth Vader.
Nice.
Greg Pak and, no, I'm going to mispronounce this, Rafael Inico.
Oh, yeah, I know who you're talking about, yeah.
I love that this book has a consistent artist and writer team. Can I say that again? I love that this, speaking for big two books, rather, mm-hmm. It's refreshing, and it helps for the consistency and tone of the book so much, as opposed to having a fill-in artist every couple issues or whatever the case may be. So big props to this. It did get caught up in the Crimson Rain event, which sometimes can be a detractor, but they did a great job of kind of, well, it's Darth Vader, so you kind of have to make sure you participate, but limiting almost to a degree how much you had to read of the other books. They did a great job of that, at least.
Is the Crimson Rain one the one that's about Kira and like all the stuff that's going on with like the Crimson Dawn and whatnot?
Yeah, exactly right.
When I heard that was happening, I was pretty interested in that. I haven't read it yet, but I, as somebody who really enjoys, it was Clone Wars that had the stuff in there about like all that stuff and how Darth Maul was kind of putting that group together and everything. I really love that stuff. I find it to be really interesting. So I might actually have to go and read it. Also, I do want to say all the Darth Vader books in the Marvel era have been really good.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Soul's work was great. Pack's great.
Kieran Gillen's one was awesome.
Kieran Gillen, yeah. How could I forget that one? That was a good one. That was a really good one.
Yeah, they've all been really good. What is your number seven?
Number seven for me takes us back to Mr. Chip Zdarsky with Daredevil.
Ooh, nice.
I love what Zdarsky's been doing with Daredevil in general. I've really enjoyed him and the Elektra combination. I don't want to spoil too much, but what they've been doing with their relationship is it is tied with the hand and all that. And then
Fist. That's their group.
Yeah. They've just been doing a great job. Zdarsky just has the tone for Daredevil down as best as I've ever seen it, mm-hmm. in my opinion. I'm not like the biggest Daredevil fan, but like I really love Bendis's stuff. But I think Zdarsky is really getting to the point where he's peak Bendis, but maybe better.
Whoa.
It's just so good, man. It's so good.
I know. I mean, it's just like Daredevil. The funny thing about Daredevil, I mentioned Swamp Thing earlier about how Swamp Thing is like this history of like having top creators on it. And I would say Daredevil is probably considered to be like the pound for pound, like greatest title in the history of Marvel. Just because like you had Frank Miller and like David Mazzucchelli do like Born Again and stuff together there. And I think like Born Again is my favorite Marvel comic ever. And then you have like Andocenti and like John Romita Jr. You have Bendis and like Maleev and everybody else. And then I love like The Devil in Cell Block D by Ed Brubaker and Michael Lark. And then just keep going. I mean, like the Mark Waid and Chris Somney stuff was awesome. And then Zdarsky and Marco Cicchetto. I mean, that's the funny thing, though, is like it's hard to go wrong with any of them. It's like if you say Zdarsky is your favorite, what am I going to do? I'm like, I can't disagree with it. It's really good.
Yeah, because I honestly haven't read a lot of the Frank Miller stuff. So like Born Again, I need to read that because aren't they doing the whole Netflix series based on that?
Yeah. Well, and also the weird thing is like the when they're doing a Disney Plus one, but the third season of the Netflix series was Born Again-ish in a very general sense. But you should read it. It's good. I'm just going to say that.
Daredevil's a big blind spot for me as far as reading.
You got a Christmas present coming your way, my friend. I'm going to mail you something and I think you'll enjoy it. Anyways, keep talking about Daredevil.
Yeah. And then this is another one of those books where you just have a synergy between writer and artist that is just, I can't imagine one without the other on this book. I know we do sometimes have to have that occur and it goes off and it goes well, but overall just having the pair together is so good. And just having, again, the continuation of Luke Cage, Me and the Mayor, is just phenomenal. I love Luke Cage, and Luke Cage Mayor is about the best position that character could be in right now.
I will say that the guy that they have step in for Marco Cicchetto is Rafael Della Torre, and he does a really good job. Like if you could get anybody to fill in for that book, it would be him. Also, I want to say that like that dude, the college friend of Elektra and Daredevil, who's now like the god fate dude, is freaky. That dude's freaky. I don't like him. He's freaking me out. I'm glad he exists because, you know, freaky is good in this situation, but he's still freaky. I don't know, man. I'm uneasy about that dude.
Fair enough.
Was that your seven?
Yeah.
Okay. Seven for me is this graphic novel called The Joy of Quitting, which was a collection of strips by this cartoonist named Keeler Roberts. I'm going to just tell you a quick story. So I read in bed primarily.
Ooh la la.
And I was reading in bed and I was like over on my side and I was just like reading through it. And this book was making me laugh really hard. But I don't know why, but like I try to suppress my laughter when I'm in bed and like Amber is right next to me because I don't want her to think I'm a total weirdo. So instead of like laughing like a normal person, I'm just like having these weird like sounds come out of my nose. And she's like, David, what are you doing? And I'm just like, this book was just killing me. It was making me laugh so much. It is an incredibly funny book that's based, I mean, it's about Roberts' life. It's about Roberts, like, talking about being a mother and being a wife and, being married and having a family and, like, about her experiences with her family and being very, very honest about all of it to the point where one of the strips is actually about her and her husband talking about, like, whether or not, like, it'll be a bad thing if other kids ever discover that their daughter is in her comics. Which I imagine would be a very interesting thing to have growing up, you know, like where your parent is like making comics about like the antics you get into as a child and stuff like that. But it's super funny, but it's also often like really moving and it's always super surprising. It is a very, very good book that made me laugh in a very awkward way in front of my wife, which means that I will never forgive it. And I will also never forget it, which is really saying something. Really good book. Kind of came out of nowhere. I didn't expect it to finish this high, but I just kept thinking about how much it made me laugh. And I loved it. Number six for me is a Skybound horror series from Kyle Starks, Artyom Topalin, Lee Loveridge, and Pat Brousseau. It's called I Hate This Place. It was originally called Fuck This Place, but they changed the name because basically, a lot of people probably thought it'd be a bad idea to have that name in comic shops everywhere because, you know, family stores and everything. But anyway, so they changed it to I Hate This Place. They still have a variant that says Fuck This Place, which I love. It is basically a story about a, in a a very overly simplified way, a haunted house. It's really like a haunted ranch. It's like a haunted area where basically there's everything from zombies to ghosts to weird spider creatures to like a horned man who does varying bad things if you get near him. And it's like these two young women who are married. They inherit this place and they go and live there. And then they find out that this place is just basically a nightmare that they can't leave. And it's about them dealing with it. And the horror stuff is great. But the thing that's really amazing about it is it's like kind of a little of every genre in there. It's like, it's funny. It's horrific. It's like, you're really invested in these characters. It's just like everything you want from pure entertainment. It's just a really, really good book. And Topolin's art is really great. And as per usual, Kyle Starks makes amazing characters with very funny lines. There's a character in it called, his name is Dante Howitzer. Like a cannon, like Dante or like Howitzer, awesome. A cannon. Yeah, his name is Dante Howitzer, and he's like a ghost hunter, and he is like the breakout comic character of 2022 for me. He is super entertaining. Anyways, I just really love it. It's super fun. It's just a really good book, and its second arc is coming up soon, and bad things will happen, but I will enjoy them happening because, unfortunately, that's their lot in life and my lot in life. What's your number five?
My number five happens to be Amazing Spider-Man.
Ooh. Zeb Wells and the John Romita Jr. stuff?
Yep. Also some of the Gleason stuff, too, with like Goblin and stuff. But overall, like just the current run, even when they pivoted, they still kind of kept some of the storylines running.
Oh, wait. I think I just messed up your order. I think you're on six.
Oh, yeah, you're right. It's still Amazing Spider-Man.
Okay.
Yeah, I've got my little cursor on it, so I know where I'm at. I enjoyed everything they did with like Hobgoblin bringing him in and like playing up who the identity of the Hobgoblin was. I thought that was a fun little mystery, even if the payoff wasn't as, you know, everything that I hoped it would be. It was still a satisfying payoff. And everything they've done with Ben Reilly and just kind of fucking up his life and making his life just miserable and turning him heel. The heel turn, well, if you're not a wrestling fan, like the bad guy turn. The heel turn for Ben Reilly is just, it's been perfect. You can see why he's so pissed off. You can see why he would potentially do what he does. And then, you know, coming over and making deals with people who, I don't want to spoil anything, but making deals on the side. So, yeah, I've really enjoyed the run. I thought they've had some great artists. We even had Dodson on at one point, Terry Dodson.
Mm-hmm.
And I love me some Dodson.
That's awesome. The funny thing is like, I've heard it's polarizing, but you and somebody else I really trust like it. And so it makes me really think I should read it. I haven't read it yet.
I didn't know it was polarizing. See, I love hearing them like, stuff I like is polarizing. That's funny.
I think it's because I don't know if people who read Marvel comics are super familiar with JRJR anymore because he's been doing DC stuff for a bit. And I don't know if they like kind of buy into his style. I love John Romita Jr. though, so I would be in on it. Anyways, it is kind of funny. I mean, I don't even know why it's polarizing. I just know that people have been kind of mixed on it, but whatever. What is number five for you?
Number five for me, the actual five, is Batman Beyond the White Knight. Sean Gordon Murphy and Dave Stewart, right?
Sure. I know it's Sean Gordon Murphy, so I imagine that it probably is Dave Stewart.
Yeah, Dave Stewart on colors. Yeah, this is how, like, we talked earlier about how you structure things. Like, not everything has to be an ongoing. Sometimes you can do minis and still keep that continuity and keep a build-up.
Mm-hmm.
This is the way that they've done the White Knight stuff, and by they, I mean him, Sean Gordon Murphy, the way he's laid this out, even if he hasn't done every single one, the way he's laid out the universe and the way they've told the stories within those pockets has been phenomenal. And I really enjoy this. I love bringing in the Batman Beyond elements into it and kind of progressing everything further into the future and seeing that time shift. The weird relationship between Harley Quinn and Batman is just so odd, but it works so well. And then obviously I love seeing some Red Hood up in here, but yeah, it's...
And it looks good.
It is one of the superior Batman products out there, out of the 6 million that are out there. It is the cream of the crop. It is up there as cream of the crop.
I love that there's so many comparison points. There's got to be like a tier system to all the Batman books.
There really could be. You could level them out, I'm sure, if you took a time.
Yeah. Number five for me is a graphic novel by Zoe Thorogood called It's Lonely at the Center of the Earth. And it's basically about a 6-month span in Thorogood's life where just basically she's living, and it's like she has she's dealing with a lot of different things. She's dealing with the pandemic, she's dealing with her place in comics, she's dealing with her own, you know, issues, she's dealing with all kinds of things, and it results in like one of the most honest and inventive and fascinating and frightening and funny and incredibly smart books I've read. Well, I mean, obviously this year it's number 5 on my list, but the thing about it is like there are regular parts of this book where Thorogood is doing things that I've never seen done in comics before, like ever, like just doing, like basically inventing ways to do things. And it's really incredible to see that. And also it's kind of funny because Thorogood had done another book I really liked called The Impending Blindness of Billy Scott. And that was great. And it was funny because like in this book, she talks about the response to it and how everyone is always like, oh, it was so relatable. Oh, it was so relatable. And I think one of the things that I find really interesting about it is like, you know, her experiences are not super relatable for me. It's interesting to get insight into somebody who's so different from me and see how she feels and how she executes that on the page. It is a book unlike anything else that was produced this year in comics. It is a singular work by a singular person, and that is incredible by itself. It is an astonishing comic, but again, very good year. A very good year with a lot of really great stuff, including my number 4, which was Squire by Sarah Alphagee and Nadia Shamas. This book's it's an alternate history story set in the Jordan area when a young girl that's born to a people that you know, generally just treated like second-class citizens, she wants to live and become more than what she is, and so she leaves to become a knight. She wants to become a squire, which will lead her to a better life, which will lead her to become a knight. And it's all about her journey to, like, become that person that she wants to be and knows that she can be. And it's just incredibly well done. The art is unbelievable. The whole thing, you love Isa, who's the main character. You just can't help but be really invested in her story. She's such a firecracker and such a badass, but also just very charming. And the thing I really like about it is it's like a lot of times books like this really succeed when it's a singular vision, but this finds two creators who really see what they want and then just execute it perfectly. I love this book. It's fantastic. What's number 4 for you?
Number 4 for me takes us back into the Batman universe with Nightwing.
Nightwing. Nice.
Nightwing by Tom Taylor and a Bruno whole Redondo. Of artists. Yeah. I love this book. I feel like it's a fun play with Dick Grayson. And I feel like it does a good job of having its own corner of the DC universe while still being a Batman title. It doesn't feel like it's completely entangled in the Bat books. I feel like you don't have to read anything but Nightwing really to understand what's going on in Nightwing, which makes it one of the few DC and Marvel books out there that feel that way to me anymore.
I can completely agree with that because I'm pretty much only reading Nightwing and I love it.
Yeah. It's phenomenal to have just such a great standalone book. It reminds me a lot of Hawkeye, Matt Fraction's Hawkeye.
Oh yeah. I could see that.
And just the way that it had its, you know, not necessarily a little bit of the vibe too, for sure, but the way it was able to keep its own little pocket in a universe and still be part of everything and feel important and feel like it belonged. Yeah, it's just such a well done book. Tom Taylor really does a great job. They even did the Nightmite issue.
I love the Nightmite issue. That's Danielle DiNiculo, and that issue is fun.
That's the artist. Yeah. That was a fun issue. I usually don't like the mites, bat mites.
Yeah.
None of that. But that was a lot of fun. That really made me like I was cracking up. Yeah, it's just a great book. The covers are phenomenal typically as well. The bat mite or the night mite issue with doing the bat tootsie.
Yeah.
Was fantastic. And I love everything they've been building with Barbara Gordon too and him.
Yeah. So I think they do a really good job of like kind of playing with expectations and doing things like a little bit differently. Like the whole thing being built around him, like wanting to make a foundation with Alfred's money is just really great. Like I love all that. Yeah. Also, I love Bitewing. I'm like a big Bitewing fan. Like having the dog, the three-legged dog in there is just like absolutely killer. It's so good. What is number 3 for you?
Number 3 for me stays in the Batman universe with Batman by Chip Zdarsky and Jorge Jimenez. Yeah. Fantastic book. This is another one of those where I feel like if you wanted a Batman book to look like a Batman book, like, this is it. Jimenez has nailed it. Like, absolutely nailed it. This is right now the best looking Batman book out there to me. Not to say that there aren't other good ones. There's just a million of them, and this is the best.
It's funny because I actually just wrote about Jorge Jimenez earlier for a thing that's going up tomorrow. And the thing I wrote basically was like, I don't think that there's a person who more perfectly fits the superhero genre right now. Like, he kind of defines it with like how he does that. Did you read the most recent issue yet? Number 130?
Yeah.
The moon stuff was so fun. I was so crazy.
So fucking cool.
Oh my God. I was dying reading that. And I love the scene where Tim Drake's like, what are you doing? I thought you were supposed to stay away from Superman. He's like, how did you end up here? He's like, I fell from the moon, and just doesn't even say anything else. It's just so perfect. It's so funny. I don't know. That book is really good. I love the failsafe stuff. I remember when Chip originally said that he was going to do his version of Doomsday, basically. Mm-hmm. It's like, I don't know. It's really great. I also love the fact it's kind of built off of Tower of Babel. The JLA story that that Mark Waid did with Howard Porter. I always love that story, and like this kind of being built off of that, and like his own plan to stop himself is like, I don't know. It feels very Batman. If anybody's going to come up with their own plan, it's like, what happens if I get out of control? I need something to kill me. I'm going to build a murder robot.
And you know, it's not like something he just did in 5 minutes. He spent a significant amount of time finding a device and creating a device to kill himself.
I know. I mean, if anybody's going to come with an elaborate plan to kill themselves, it would definitely be Batman. It's a really good book. I like it a lot. God, we are definitely in the Batman section for sure.
Yeah.
Number three for me is Do a Powerbomb by Daniel Warren Johnson, Mike Spicer, and Russ Wooten. It is a wrestling book, so I imagine it is one that you would be enthusiastic about. I have suspicions of things, but we'll see what happens there. But it is basically a story about a tag team group in a intergalactic wrestling tournament who are both wrestling to bring somebody back to life. And it's about family, and it's about wrestling, and it's about crazy necromancers, and it's about just Daniel Warren Johnson absolutely going off as an artist. It is one of the most glorious, insane, action-packed, fun, and moving comics in recent memory. The final issue has them, I don't even know if I want to spoil it, but let's just say they're wrestling somebody on high, and it is very unexpected as to who they have their finale wrestling. And it's just so good. It's like, it's an emotional journey. That's the thing I really love about Daniel's stuff, is it's like, it's ultra badass and it's incredibly drawn, but it also is very emotional. It always is. There's always like this emotional through line that really like just pops, and I love it. It's super good. Number two for me is bringing back one of the most common names from this. It's Zdarsky. Chip Zdarsky. He wrote and drew and colored and did all the other things for a series called Public Domain this year at Image, which is a story about the story about making comics and how that's not always a fair experience. And like, it's basically about creator rights and like this artist who created this character called the Domain, who becomes like a, you know, movie superstar and makes tons of money for a corporation who owns them, while the guy who created him like doesn't make a ton off of it, but you know, he's happy with his position. But his son, who's a bit of a malcontent, starts pushing him in the direction of doing something about it. And it is constantly very surprising. It is very fun. It is very charming. It's very heartfelt. Like the story about the family is very, it's about real family, but it's also about found family. And it's about like finding connections through stories and through comics and everything. And I love Chip. And I'm going to say this, despite the fact that I love many things that Chip has done, it's the best thing Chip Zdarsky's ever done. It is so good. It's great. I highly recommend it to everyone. It is like a slice of life story that's very small, and it's about people and everything, but it's just pure Chip in all the best ways. Highly recommended. What is your number two?
Number two for me takes us at least a step out of the Batman universe and into Batman and Superman, World's Finest.
I love it.
This book was, to me, the best superhero book on the market this year. It was so much fun. I love the classic takes that Dan Mora's got with the costumes, the old Batman with the yellow oval, bringing back the classic Robin with the pixie boots look. Just overall, the vibe of it is so good. And the action scenes by Mora are so awesome. And at some point in there, he draws Lex Luthor in his armor. And I'm a huge stan for that armor, and he kills it. But I also love that it does tie into what's going on in the universe with Nezna.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if I'm not right. But Nezna, the like Trigon almost looking dude, who's actually playing into some of what's going on with Williamson stuff over with Robin and the Lazarus stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So it does have a tie there. So it's not like it's completely insular, but it does feel insular in the way that it's told in a very classic and fun way.
That's awesome. Dan Mora, man.
Yeah.
That guy is, I don't know how he draws so much and all of it's so good, but he's a magician. He's incredible.
Yeah. I will buy anything with his name on it at this point.
Once in future. You got to read it. Anyways, number one. What's your number one?
My number one is a book that you may have suspected was my number one.
Do a Powerbomb?
Do a Powerbomb.
Aha!
Absolutely fucking love this book. As a huge wrestling fan and as a huge Daniel Warren Johnson fan, this couldn't have been a better combination.
Yeah.
Just the love and the detail that he shows to the wrestling world is phenomenal. I know David didn't want to spoil it earlier, and so I won't spoil it either. But that final match, the person on high using a crucifix move, was phenomenal. Just the detail again. Just the detail was so good. And it is so relatable and heartfelt, and it just feels fully actualized and realized. And just the tag teams they fight and their backstories and getting it to see why they're in the tournament trying to bring back somebody. Just phenomenal book for a lot of the reasons David touched upon as well. But for me, again, to add something else onto that David didn't mention is just, again, the love and the detail to the wrestling world was just so fucking awesome.
How did you feel about the mother or the father-daughter relationship? I feel like that probably hit you.
I thought that was great. I understood completely like why he didn't tell her the full truth. You know what I mean? Like that's,
yeah,
that would be heartbreaking.
Were you surprised by the twist? I don't want to say what that is either in case like somebody's trade waiting it, but it's just like the twist involving them.
Yeah, I was surprised.
I was too. Daniel does a really good job of obfuscating that to like some degree where it's just like you don't see that coming. That's one of the things that's really impressive about that book is like every issue that I feel like I've figured it out, I realize I don't have it figured out. Also, I do want to say that this is one of the only times I've ever read a comic where the violence actually made me like physically wince. There was like some times where it was so intense where I was like, oh boy, this is bad. These people need a doctor. And it turns out several times they actually did need a doctor or worse in multiple instances. It's an incredible book. I'm so glad you read it because I knew as soon as I started reading it, I was like, oh my God, Brandon's going to love this book.
Well, and it's one of those things where like we talked about certain people, like his stuff I'll pick up no matter what at this point. I mean, he's done Beta Ray Bill was phenomenal.
Murder Falcon
was phenomenal. So at this point, and Do a Powerbomb is better than both of those, which is crazy to me because I love both of those books. So, yeah, I can't wait to see what's next. Do you know what's next?
For him?
Yeah.
I don't know what's next. I'll be interested to see. I mean, honestly, whatever he wants to do. If it's like his own thing. I talked to him before about figuring out how to do a baseball book. I would love it if he would do a baseball book. But I know that I recognize that that's a difficult thing to do. However, he did do, I showed you that commission he did for me. It was Beta Ray Bill using Stormbreaker as a baseball bat. And he did it at Fenway Park. If anybody can make that interesting, it's going to be Daniel Warren Johnson.
Absolutely.
My number one book is a book by one of my favorite cartoonists and comics. It's Ducks 2 Years in the Oil Sands by Kate Beaton. Kate Beaton is somebody who, I mean, like I said, already one of my favorite comic creators ever. I love, like, she did this webcomic called Hark a Vagrant that is very funny and very smart and just incredibly well done. It's all these strips and everything. This is even better than Hark a Vagrant. It's a look at her time working in Alberta's oil industry, which, you know, as people who were raised in Alaska, a lot of it, I could see a lot of Alaska in this, and I could see a lot of, like, our home in this. And it's about like all the pain and heartbreak and horror and experiences that come along with. I mean, honestly, it is like a harrowing read at times to like see the experiences she had. This is like an autobiographical comic, and no comic this year had me more engaged. No comic had me more enraged. Like, I was genuinely mad reading it at times because of the experiences she had. And I had like no comic I was more enamored by. I loved it. It is a remarkable work by a remarkable talent, and my comic of the year for sure. It was funny because most of the time I do a lot of flopping when it comes to number one. I can't ever decide. This one, as soon as I read it, I put it at number one and it never moved. It's just a masterpiece. It is like one of the best comics I've read in years. And it's just incredible. I mean, I don't really need to say anything about it because it's one of the most touted comics in recent memory. It's winning many, many awards and many, many like end of the year things. And yeah, I can't say it any better than they can. But yeah, that was my favorite book of the year. A lot of great books. I love that we both had Do a Powerbomb in our top three. That's amazing.
It's a great book.
It's a great book. It was a great book, a great year, and as per usual, a great podcast with you, Brandon. Thank you for joining me to talk about our 20 favorite books of the year and everything else. I appreciate you taking the time.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Thanks for listening to this week's episode of Off Panel with my pal, Brandon Burpee. You can find him on Instagram at @vinylburpee. Big thanks to Deanna Chapman, who stepped in and edited this podcast, is probably the reason why it sounds better than usual. Love Off Panel, want to support it? Subscribe to the podcast on Apple Podcasts today and give the show a rating or review while you're at it, but 5 stars only. You can also support the show by backing it on Patreon. Find the show on patreon.com/offpanel. And when you pack it on there, you get early access to each week's podcast, as well as weekly content and more. Want even more? Subscribe to my subscription comic site, Sketched, at Sketched.com for long-form articles, interviews, and the rest of the site's content. You can find Off Panel and Sketched on social media by following on Twitter and Instagram at @SketchComic or following me at @SliceFriedGold. Big thanks to all my existing patrons, including Brian, Matteo Ciccati, Jeremy Lambert, Chris Dore, Nir Levy, Dennis Hoffman, Jason Hussa, Cancel Comics, Kieran Gillen, Jonathan Kent Uritam, Henry Johnson, Django Bowen, James Tynan IV, Chris Langford, Jason Wood, Tom Peachy, Ben Damstead, Ron B., Devin Fitzsimons, Nick Walker, Patrick Coyle, Isaac Oren, Scott Carpenter, Rent Norb Studios Comics, Nicholas Palmieri, Capes and Tights Podcast, Klaus Vandevan, Brian, Submit Industries, Raj Patel, Jack Mulqueen, Kyle Carl Kershaw, Robert Masella, Elza Chartier, Luke Nakashoji, Elliot Metz, Dr. Luke, Scott Hazelwitz, Michael Tunk, Canadian by Proxy, Johnny Cannon, Bradley Raider, Carl Troy, Brandon DePillis, Patrick Brower, Declan Chalvey, Dan Guarino, Josh Williamson, Adam Freeman, Ben Wild, Brian Klein Q, SB, Nick Bennett, Daniel Whitfield, Susanna Polo, Reed Hinkley Barnes, Mario Tiambang, AbductedTheComic.com, Andrew Carita, Matt Mahoney, Stephen Hall, Pensacola Pop Comics, Kim Eslam, Philip Myra, Christian Shelton, Kenny Porter, Chris Pachalo, Torin Grunbeck, Buzz Bubbles, Chris Rital, Transmitter Down, Waltz Comics and Books, Danny Ollie, Paul Salates, Akil Wilson, Alex Dimitriopoulos, Terry Dodson, Wesley Giff, Sean Kirkham, Alistair Ross, Julio Anta, Brett A. Schmidt, Jason Goodmanson, Paul Reinwan, Vieta Ayala, Dave Slusher, Akil Kokachi, Sean Pinnell, Ken Heidelman, Philip Seavey, Al Ewing, David Kelly, Robert Wilson IV, Nick Polito, Brendan Fletcher, Jonathan Nielsen, Jason Nassi, Adam Bogart, Matthew Taylor, Nick Patera, Jacob Sorelli, Ford Gilmore, Dave Baraldi, Nick Hall, Bjorn Basin, John Hendrick, Steve Anderson, Ian Maxfield, Cliff Chang, Colin McMahon, Chris Palmer, Scott McGovern, Nathan Fairbairn, Kat McKenzie, Adam Highfield, Fiona Staples, Mark Abnett, Mike Murphy, Michael Shirley, Tom Barnett, Jim DeBenacos, Norbert, Nicklo, James Kaplan, and Mission Comics Art in San Francisco. You guys are all the best. A quick thanks to Upright T-Rex Music, who wrote and performed Off Panel's theme song just for the show. Check out their music on Spotify because it's completely delightful. Thanks for listening, and tune in next week for another episode.